X-minus 18 minutes.
Pressure slightly high. Nothing to be alarmed about, though. Quite understandable under the circumstance.
The weaker sex. The only one whose blood pressure is normal.
X minus 17 minutes.
With you in the assembly hall in another minute, shall we go?
Good luck.
Thank you, Doctor, and good night.
Ladies and gentlemen, every news service and newspaper is represented here tonight. And for your cooperation in the past, when complete secrecy was vital, we are grateful. However, I must make something clear. Although ours is not strictly a military project, a great deal of our research and knowledge falls within security regulations. Therefore, I must insist that you reveal only such information as appears in the authorized press release, which will be handed to you later. I'm sure that we can all recall the wild tales of the flying discs, flying saucers, spaceships, and who knows what imaginative creations. The press is to be commended for discounting, in most instances, these premature rumors, and so helping to minimize public apprehension. Tonight, you are invited here to witness an important event. You are all familiar with our previous work in sending robot missiles into space. That phase is at an end. Tonight we will launch the first manned spaceship, the RXM, Rocketship Expedition Moon.
X minus 15 minutes.
Forever, man has dreamed of visiting the nearest of heavenly bodies. Some for adventurous, fantastic reasons. Others, like ourselves, because they visualized a successful lunar expedition as the first step toward practical interplanetary travel. Today, there is even the possibility that an unassailable base could be established on the moon to control world peace. I will now introduce to you the head of this expedition and his crew. Dr. Carl Ekstrom, designer of the RXM, and as you all know, one of the most brilliant physicists of the day, and an old friend. Dr. Lisa Van Horn, his most able co-worker and assistant, doctor of chemistry. Colonel Floyd Graham, pilot. Mr. Harry Chamberlain, astronomer of the Mount Wilson and Palomar Observatory staffs. Mr. Chamberlain will serve as navigator. Major William Corrigan, engineer. I shall now ask Dr. Ekstrom to outline the flight plan for you. Carl?
X minus 14 minutes.
The distance between the Earth and the Moon at its closest proximity is 238,000 miles. We expect to cover this distance in approximately 48 hours. The first phase of our flight will be the ascent to an altitude of 300 miles. From the start, while we pass through the troposphere and stratosphere, until we reach the ionosphere, the flight will be controlled by our automatic pilot. After we have climbed through the atmosphere, we will turn the rocket into a parallel course with the surface of the Earth. In flying parallel with the Earth's surface, we receive added boost from its rotation.
X minus 13 minutes.
The RXM is what is known as a multi-stage or step rocket. Upon reaching escape velocity, the tail section, which has housed the fuel to attain this speed, will be jettisoned. The nose section, which is a complete rocket containing enough fuel for the entire trip and also containing our cabin, overcomes the gravitational pull of the Earth and heads in the direction of the Moon. After we have passed the equilibrium point where the Earth and the Moon's gravities are in balance, we will reduce power to a minimum. The Moon's attraction will carry us the rest of the way. Finally, we will reverse the rocket, utilizing the thrust of its motors to make our landing. A few more details which might interest you. The cabin is pressurized and gyro-controlled, keeping us in a level position at all times. We carry radar for navigation, shortwave for communication, and most important, more than twice the amount of fuel we expect to use to keep well within the margin of safety.
X minus 12 minutes.
We still have a few moments, ladies and gentlemen, for questions, if any of you care to.
Chamberlain, how do you fit into the picture? Do you have any family?
No, I've been living on mountaintops. I'm afraid it's too lonely for such opportunities.
Have you ever done any flying?
Only as a passenger.
But you're the navigator.
But you must realize that interstellar flight requires far more exact and precise navigation than any earthbound voyage.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, that's incidental.
It is?
Yes. You see, as an astronomer, I can appreciate the perfect observation conditions on a body without atmosphere, such as our moon. Do you realize that within one hour...
I've got about 800 head grazing down there. I bought my ranch with the flight pay I saved up during the war.
Mm-hmm. How does your wife feel about you going?
Well, she's a Texan, too, and... Well, she knows that when a Texas man makes up his mind to do something, that's it. Period. Say, I wish you fellas could have seen her face, so when I walked in and told her, in the strictest confidence, of course... Honey, I'm going to the moon.
What did she say?
Well, she looked at me for a second and then said, what for? They ain't got nothing there that we don't have more of right here in Texas.
We've already made the trip 100 times.
What?
In the training room. Yeah, I've done more flying this last month than I've done over 100 missions. And believe me, this is the hottest crew I've ever worked with, especially in the brains department.
Yeah, very attractive, too.
Yeah, I agree. But, and you can quote me on this, unless you look like a test tube or a chemical formula, you haven't got a chance.
From the woman's angle, Dr. Van Horn, how does it feel making a trip like this alone with four men?
To tell you the truth, I never thought much about it.
Well, tell me, Doctor, is there any specific reason why one member of the crew should be a woman?
I'd like to answer that, if I may.
Certainly.
The reason Miss Van Horn is making this trip is because of her pioneering research with monatomic hydrogen. It enabled her to develop the first rocket fuel, powerful and concentrated enough to make this flight possible.
X minus 11 minutes.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are pressed for time. You may view the takeoff from the observation bunker and return to this room immediately afterward. Everybody, return here after the takeoff.
X minus 7 minutes.
Gyro control and compass okay.
Battery's all up, autopilot's okay, everything's in order.
Let's go. I've checked these calculations many times, they're perfectly correct. Oh yes, all commercial flights have been detoured 100 miles south.
Thank you. Well, I can't think of anything we've overlooked. All we need now is a little luck.
It doesn't seem real. The moment finally has arrived after all these years.
Has been a long time.
A long time for two men to work together.
You remember when we started, what they called us?
Young crackpots.
Yes, and what are we now? Maybe just crackpots.
The only regret I have is that I must stay behind.
Your job is no less important, Robert.
I know, but still...
X minus 6 minutes.
Carl, good luck.
Good luck, everybody.
Better take one more look. We won't be as close as this to Mother Earth for some time.
Everything in order.
X minus 3 minutes.
No change in flight plans discussed. First 7 minutes of flight controlled by automatic pilot.
Pilot's ready.
7 minutes straight ascent.
Straight ascent from starting point.
Starting thrust using all tail assembly engines, 2,300 tons.
Right.
Fuel mixture?
Hydrogen and oxygen plus A12. After 120 seconds, hydrogen and oxygen plus A14. After 340 seconds, hydrogen plus A16.
After 560 seconds, A16.
Right.
Any questions?
X minus 2 minutes.
Good luck.
Minus 1 minute. X minus 50 seconds. X minus 40 seconds. X minus 30 seconds. X minus 20 seconds. X minus 10 seconds.
X minus 5 seconds. 4,
3, 2, 1, 0.
Attempt to establish radio contact with the ship.
Okay.
human body can withstand these accelerations. But it certainly was never meant to.
I feel like I was just tossed off a spooky bronc.
Are you all right, Doctor?
Oh, yes, can't hurt an old campaigner like me.
How about you? You all right?
Certainly.
Radar and gyro compass in order.
Automatic pilot okay.
Fuel consumption?
Normal.
Air pressure?
15 pounds. Sight, isn't it?
It is.
You can study maps and globes and try to visualize. But the actual experience, it's hard to express it.
Stand by to turn. Stand by. 4, 3, 2, turn.
Flight speed, 3,400 miles per hour.
Altitude, 360 miles.
How do we stand on fuel now?
3/10 of fire left in tail section.
Mixture at present?
A-16.
Harry, contact the base.
Right. RXM, calling BWS. RXM, calling BWS. Over.
Come in, RXM. Over to you.
Stand by, BWS.
Ekstrom speaking.
We have leveled off at 360 miles altitude and are circling the globe at 3,400 miles per hour. We will increase speed gradually until we reach escape velocity of 25,000 miles per hour. Everyone aboard ship, well. Over to you.
We'll be standing by.
5,500 miles.
Continue acceleration.
Hey, what happened to the rest of the night?
I'm afraid we ran right out of it.
If it's darkness you want, wait till we enter outer space. The realm of perpetual night.
6,000. 6,200 miles per hour.
Radar is tracking them perfectly.
I had contact with them 4 minutes ago. Altitude, 1,600 miles. Speed, 21,000 miles per hour. Constantly increasing. They are about to reach escape velocity.
22,000.
Bill, check the pressurizing system and oxygen.
Boy, this kind of weather makes me feel right at home. It's like a nice, cool night in East Texas.
24,000.
Take a reading the moment we attain escape velocity.
Yes.
Stand by. 25,000.
Prepare to jettison tail section.
Start the front assembly motors. Only 40 seconds supply of fuel left.
Hold on tight, everybody.
You ready?
Go.
Reduce power.
Look out!
That was a little too close for comfort. We might be in a vacuum, but I sure felt the wind of that one.
Harry, contact the base again.
RXM calling BWS. Over.
Come in, RXM. Over to you.
Stand by, BWS.
We're on our way.
We have jettisoned tail section and are now reducing power and speed according to plan until we come within the attraction of the moon. This probably last radio contact before return flight. Everybody aboard well.
BWS calling RXM. BWS calling RXM. Come in, RXM.
Ladies and gentlemen, we had hoped by having the entire press represented here tonight to eliminate any possible hearsay, rumor, or speculation from your reports. However, I regret to have to ask you to confine yourselves to the official news release. I promise to hand you any news that may come in as soon as it can be cleared.
Don't think I like all this dark.
Well, it might be all right for sleeping, but for a steady diet, uh-uh.
I used to hate the daylight because I couldn't work. But up here in this eternal night, it's a different feeling.
A fella can get used to anything, I guess, if he has to. Now, I remember when I was first assigned to Jets. I said to the colonel, Colonel, I joined this man's Air Force to fly an airplane. But nobody's going to hitch me to no Roman candle. Now I'm sitting right inside of one. Boy, oh boy. Ain't she pretty? Can you see Texas?
No, it's in the other hemisphere. Even so, from this distance, it would only appear a mere speck.
A mere speck? Texas a mere speck? Oh, now, listen, my friend, I'm broad-minded. I've been around people, but don't you ever let any other Texan hear you say that. A mere speck. It's the funniest sensation. I feel like I'm walking in a cloud. No effort at all.
We're getting deeper and into planetary space. Gravity will soon be practically non-existent.
Look, we got a stowaway aboard.
Hey, whoa. I need you.
Don't you think it's amusing?
There's nothing funny about that. Simply the lack of gravity.
Oh, of course, Dr. Van Horn. Better make sure our equipment's fastened down.
Now, don't get mad at me, but can't you ever relax? All these weeks, months, I've been watching you. Nothing but work, work, work.
You know, I've been wondering, how does a girl like you get mixed up in a thing like this in the first place?
I suppose you think that women should only cook and sew and bear children.
Isn't that enough? There's such a thing as going overboard in the other direction, too, yeah. If you don't watch it.
I'll check the engines.
Bill, pressurize the motor room first.
Pressure up.
still drifting. After 14 hours and 12 minutes, we've covered 112,000 miles. We'll come within the gravitational attraction of the moon.
Well, that's not important right now. Without power, we're helplessly suspended in space. Even if we were already within the gravitational reach, we'd still be unable to make a landing. We need power to land.
Checked and double-checked all connections. Primers. Fuel injectors. Can't find a thing wrong.
And it must be the fuel mixture.
How much oxygen do we carry?
Don't worry. We have plenty left for the trip.
So the trip is planned, you mean?
Differential 6 over M to the 30th power, the halfway check result is 262,000 to 341,000, both using tangent E, correct?
That isn't the result I have.
It must be the same. There's an error there.
I've made no error, Dr. Ekstrom.
I have to say that you made an error and discard your figures. I'm sorry.
Don't be.
Surely you're not going to let emotion enter into this.
Certainly not.
We'll continue computing using my results as a basis.
Yes, Doctor. Except that I feel very strongly, I should say, that we should try both.
We can't. To complete either calculation would take 6 to 8 hours. We can't afford the time. It's either one or the other, Dr. Van Horn.
But it doesn't have to be. You can't be arbitrary about imposing your will when these people's lives are at stake. Don't you realize that? You speak as calmly as if you were saying pass the salt. Aren't you human? Are you made of ice? I'm sorry. I apologize.
For what? For momentarily being a woman? It's completely understandable, Miss Van Horn. Now, shall we go ahead?
Yes, Doctor.
Tangent L9.
Tangent L9.
Dr. Hurley at Mount Palomar.
Yes, Dr. Hurley? Yes?
We located the RXM's position at 7:16 this morning. Since then, there has been very little change.
Apparently, their velocity is far lower than we anticipated. Are you sure, Doctor?
Thank you.
Suspended in space.
Would you do something for me, please?
Sure.
I need those two grafts under Dr. Ekstrom's arm. I'm tired and shaky. I might awaken him.
know the feeling.
I wouldn't rob him of his sleep for anything.
I knocked over a 10-foot Christmas tree once, all decorated, my cousin's house, just from trying to do something when I was too tired. It's about 1 o'clock in the morning. Kids woke up, came rushing in. First they thought I was Santa Claus lying there with a busted tinsel star on my nose. I spoiled everything.
Yes. Thanks.
It's no trouble. Why don't you take a minute off from that? You're worn out.
I can't.
You'll think clearer if you do. When I was flying in the war, we had a guy like you in some of our long missions. Too bad.
Too bad?
Blew his top. We had to put him in Section 8. Held it in too long, never let down a second.
You're right. I'm not even thinking straight anymore. Numbers buzz in my head like wasps. I ought to think of something different.
How about that? Something no human being ever saw before.
You know, it's funny. One never thinks of the Earth that way. As a dying planet with nothing to give out but reflected light. A mere moon.
I don't speak so disrespectfully of the moon. A mere moon. I've done some of my best work by moonlight. Found its light very effective.
For navigation?
For any purpose. Don't underrate it. Moonlight's potent.
You're speaking of its effect on men and women?
On women. I don't need this stuff myself.
Oh. You're immune?
No. Just don't need it. But did you ever park in an open convertible on the cliffs overlooking the Pacific? On a warm summer night when a big moon hung up there like a lantern. The blue light from it walking across the water. Radio playing a nice tune. Waves whooshing on the beach.
Perhaps unfortunately, I never had the time nor the thought to do anything much beyond my profession.
Now, don't tell me that you never looked at that old moon except for astronomical reasons.
You're right. I have. In Rome once, and in Switzerland, at Lake Lugano. What a nice stroll.
Stroll?
Yes. Yes, we walked slowly around the edge of the lake for 2 hours.
And never stopped?
No.
Well, everybody to his own taste.
It was lovely there. The water black like cold coffee. The moonlight like flecks of ice cream floating on it. The music from the hotel ballroom. Oh, but that was so long ago. Another world. Fine scientist I am. Daydream.
It's good for you once in a while.
I suppose it is, but not now.
I still say it.
Say what?
That moonlight's effective stuff.
You're quite right.
What effect a double dose like this would have in a convertible? Nothing. Skip it.
Meteorites!
Thank you.
I've been through some pretty heavy flak in my day, but that's the worst I've ever had thrown at me. Heavenly flak. Say, maybe somebody don't want us to get where we aim to get. Oh, cheer up, Harry. After what we've been through, we'll get there all right.
Maybe it'd have been better if one of them had struck the ship. At least it'd have been sudden. Quick.
Now, your computation?
We have to add 12% O3 to A16.
Right. 12% O3 to A16. This means we'll have to rearrange some of the fuel tanks and all the connections. I will replace these H tanks with these.
Well, the motor room's pressurized.
Think you can manage a half-ton tank?
Oh, sure. Down on my ranch, I used to throw a little old 1,000-pound steer over my shoulder every morning.
Sure that wasn't a little old bull you were throwing. All right, Samson, let's see you do your stuff.
Think I was kidding, huh?
You'll never prove it to me here.
Doctor, can we be quite sure these proportions are safe? We never proved them by experiment.
The mathematical theory is beyond question.
O3, though. Sometimes it behaves unpredictably.
Woman's intuition again.
Twelve percent O3 to A16.
And chart deviation is 32 degrees. Present position is.
We'll correct course when we're in powered flight once more.
All right.
All ready?
Ready. Stand by, everybody.
That again, Dr. Hurley. Are you certain? Yes. As I see, thank you. They are completely off their course. Moving with incredible velocity. Out into limitless space. I can't understand it.
We're not getting enough oxygen.
No. Phil! Phil!
has it been since?
I'm afraid we'll never know.
How are the others?
I think everybody's going to be all right.
It must have been days.
Fortunately, the engines were turned off.
When?
I must have turned the levers off when I blacked out.
But at what speed? You know the consequences of a body moving with unchecked velocity in free space.
Infinite motion.
So we made a little detour. Now we gotta double back to that last road sign. Come on, let's go to work.
Try to determine our present velocity if possible.
Can't be. The instruments must have gone crazy.
I don't think so. By heading into space, we've added the Earth's orbital velocity to our own.
Then we're really moving.
I should say at least several times the maximum speed of your indicator. Any progress, Harry?
Should at least have an approximation of our position very shortly.
Fuel consumption?
In just a moment.
Doctor.
What?
I cut in resistances to raise the scale. But look.
Acceleration. Definite acceleration, but the motor's off. That's impossible unless...
This can't be correct.
What?
I seem to be getting a strong reflection of impulse directly ahead 50,000 miles.
That explains it.
Explains what?
Of course. Unbelievable. It couldn't be mere chance. I don't quite know how to tell you it's so. If I could have even dreamed that an incredible set of circumstances, each precisely and exactly timed, would carry us unerringly through space to our most congenial planetary neighbor, Mars, I would...
Mars?
It's utterly unbelievable.
No doubt whatsoever. Unmistakable.
Mars. What do you know?
What does it mean, Doctor?
It means there are times when a mere scientist has gone as far as he can. When he must pause and observe respectfully while something infinitely greater assumes control. I believe this is one of those times.
We shall go on, of course.
Our overall fuel consumption was...
42%.
A Martian landing, approaching a planet with atmosphere, is far easier than the lunar maneuver. Certainly we shall go on. We should be betraying an unprecedented opportunity to do otherwise.
Then I'd suggest there's a couple of little things we might do. This ship isn't going to land itself, you know.
Mark.
I'll be darned.
We must first compute the correct thrust and fuel mixture to comply with anticipated conditions.
Escape velocity, 12,500 miles an hour. Oxygen at surface level, 15%.
Prepare to change the parallel course at distance 1,500 miles.
Right. I've located them.
Located what?
The Earth and Moon.
Well, where are they?
Here, take a look.
What do you know about that?
Is it all right to call Texas a mere speck now?
As we are now in parallel flight, we are reducing speed and altitude. At 50 miles altitude, we will execute a turn of 90 degrees, bringing the rocket into landing position. Since the gravitational attraction of Mars is only half as powerful as that of Earth, a thrust of 1,200 tons will be sufficient to make the landing. Fuel?
Hydrogen and oxygen plus A12.
Altitude 70 miles. 65. 60. 55 miles.
Stand by to turn.
50.
Turn.
Thank you.
90-degree turn completed.
Reduce power.
Altitude 40 miles. 38 miles.
I only hope the light holds out. It's getting dark down below. Clear to increase thrust at altitude 15 miles. Getting darker rapidly. As far as I can make out, the terrain is suitable for landing.
Altitude 6 miles, 5 miles, 20,000 feet, 18,000.
Thrust at present, 1,250 tons.
Stand by to increase power.
15,000, 12,000, 10,000, 8,000, 7,000, 6,000.
We're losing altitude too fast. Increase thrust to 3,000 tons.
4,000 feet. 3,000. 2,000 feet.
Reduce thrust slowly to 1,250 tons.
1,000. 500.
Save the engines. Nice work, Floyd. Mars extending us a welcome. Now we're prepared to disembark first thing in the morning. In the meantime, we can rest and get our equipment ready.
Well, that's what I've been waiting for.
Yeah, I've been itching to get into one of these things.
Sorry to disappoint you, Bill. We have atmosphere here. We won't need pressure suits. Which works greatly in our favor, too. We can accomplish so much more unencumbered. As far as equipment's concerned, we'll take oxygen masks, camera, paraphernalia.
What about data for the return trip? It must be exact and precise. Hadn't we better begin preparation?
Yes, of course, you're right. We have so little time here. Such an opportunity. Let's think about that for a little while first.
Thank you.
notice the abundant coloration? Green, orange, yellow, black.
A sign of tremendous mineralization.
Manganese, copper, nickel, pitch blende. Immense deposits of pitch blende.
You figure on staking out a claim here? Just making sure we can find our way back. So far as rock and sand, sand and rocks. I wonder when we're going to run across some of these Martians. You know, from what I read, they've got pale faces and pinheads and fishy eyes.
Shall we go? Conceived this must have been of a high order of intelligence, at least the equal of Earth, perhaps considerably above ours.
To think that a complex, organized society existed here once.
Yes, from all indications, thousands of years ago.
I wonder how it happened. There's always the possibility of a meteor, but then it would have created a depression like a moon crater.
No, this wasn't caused by a meteor. This is definitely blast effect coupled with intense heat.
There's a strong field of radiation over there.
Better stop. The radioactivity is at the danger level. Ironic, isn't it? The mind of man, wherever you encounter it, Earth, highest attainments of human intellect, always devoted to self-destruction. Perhaps the entire surface of the planet is one vast ruin, like this.
Well, you think we ought to start back to the ship?
I agree to that. We're neither prepared nor equipped for any stay here.
We have supplies for several days. Let's use this precious time as effectively as we can.
I agree with Dr. Ekstrom. A day here is more valuable than years of research on Earth.
Well, okay then, let's get going.
What a lesson here for our world. One blast, thousands of years of civilization wiped out.
Could there have been any survivors?
I should hate to think so. We still don't know all the genetic effects of radiation, but that it will produce mutations, malformities, disfigurements, blindness, that much we're sure of from research. A blast like this, I should hate to think that any survived.
Why don't you try to get some rest?
If I ever get back to Texas, I'll know better than to leave again. Yes, sir.
Dr. Ekstrom! There were men out there. Look, you gotta believe me. It wasn't a nightmare. I haven't slept at all. I tell you, I saw them.
Where?
Right out there. And when I yelled, they disappeared.
All right, let's go see.
Right here. And when they heard me, they disappeared in there.
Dr. Ekstrom, look at these footprints.
It don't take a Navajo to figure out what caused these.
It's hard to believe, but
now maybe you'll agree to return to the ship.
We can't stop now. We must follow, find out what kind of creatures they are. It's tremendously important.
We don't know how many there are. And suppose they're hostile with one rifle and a pistol. We won't have a prayer.
That's the chance we have to take. You wait here. I'm going ahead.
This kind of thing is just my meat. Mind if I come along?
Thank you, Ben.
I'm with you, Doctor.
No, Floyd, you three stay.
But
I'll have to make that in order. Come on, Bill.
Thank you.
Atomic Age to Stone Age.
Bill!
Harry, we're able to help. It's impossible to get a precise result without radar.
You've done a wonderful job.
We should have fuel enough for a landing.
When will we feel the Earth's gravity?
As soon as there's an increase in speed. According to elapsed time and velocity chart, almost any minute now. But without a check from Harry, it's...
I know we're in a tight spot, but we'll manage somehow.
Any sign of increase in speed?
Not yet. You know, you're a pretty swell girl, Lisa.
Girl? I'm not Dr. Van Horn anymore?
No, just Lisa.
Doing her job?
No, I don't see it that way at all. I see a woman sweet, gentle, and beautiful.
I'm not the same?
Somehow, no.
But I am, you know. The same, I mean.
Well, maybe I've changed then, but I feel that I've never known you before.
Will you do something for me, please?
Sure, what?
Say my name the way you did a moment ago.
Lisa.
RX, I'm calling VWS. RXM calling VWS. Come in, VWS. Over. Come in, VWS. Can't contact them. They won't answer. They won't ever answer.
Of course they will.
Speed's increasing. We're gonna make it. Shut off the fuel.
Be all right.
What about the fuel? We lost so much.
Yes. Well, we'll have enough for a landing.
How are we doing?
Not so good.
Well, what's the matter? Everything's worked out so far, right in the nose.
We haven't got enough fuel for a landing. Not even for an approach.
But the motors were functioning perfectly before I shut them off.
And 1/10th capacity. I'm sorry, it's all my fault.
Maybe it's only the instruments.
Everything is lost. All Dr. Ekstrom's work in vain. Now the world will never know the terrible truth we learned.
No. Maybe there's still a chance. We must be close enough for shortwave. I'll try to contact the base.
If we only could. Report everything. Tell them as much as we can. What we saw. The mistakes that we made.
RXM calling BWS. RXM calling BWS.
Dr. Fleming.
Yes?
The radio control room just called. They've contacted the RXM.
Too much interference. You better use these, Doctor.
PWS. Fleming speaking. Calling RXM. Come in, RXM. Repeat that again, please, Dr. Van Horn. What about Dr. Ekstrom?
Now at least they know. Lloyd, hold me. Hold me tight.
I wish I knew some words that would help.
I'm sorry that we haven't had any time. That we didn't meet or know each other the way we do now sooner.
Time isn't so important.
Oh, yes, yes, it is.
Don't. We can say that time is behind us. That we've had years together.
Yes.
I can tell you about 1,000 wonderful hours we've spent together. Because I feel we would have, inevitably. And there's not that much difference between the future and the past.
Not if you feel this way about it, no. Shouldn't we wake him?
What good would it do?
None, you're right.
It's only seconds, darling.
Try not to be afraid.
Lloyd. I'm not afraid anymore. Something happened, like a great wave carrying us up, bearing us, protecting us.
Fleming?
Yes?
The men from the new syndicates are still waiting.
All right, let them come in.
Dr. Fleming, the pilot and crew of Flight 19 International Airlines observed a strange object falling over Nova Scotia. According to their report, it could have been the RXM.
My office has been getting the same story over the wires for hours.
We know the RXM has been overdue a long time. Is there any connection, Doctor?
As yet, there has been no confirmation, but... yes, I believe there is a connection.
Then they all perished in the crash.
No, two were lost earlier.
But the flight must be considered a failure.
Failure? Every point of our rocket theory has been established. It has proven that interspace travel is not only possible, but practicable. And it has supplied us with information which may well mean the salvation of our own world. No, gentlemen, the flight of the RXM was not a failure. Tomorrow we start construction of RXM-2.
The moon at its closest proximity is 238,000 miles. We expect to cover this distance in approximately 48 hours.
X minus 5 seconds.
4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
Degree turn completed.
Reduce power.
Thrill as you get a moon's eye view of Earth. Streak through a barrage of hidden dangers.
Meteorites!
Jettison tail section.
You ready? Go.
Reduce power.